us. Let's check a scripture that tells us something like that. The battle of the three kings against Moab. And I believe that you will learn from this. 2 Kings chapter 3. I will paraphrase the content before I read the verse 16 and 17 downwards. There's a battle, three kings. I mean, because the king of Israel determined to fight against the king of Moab. After the death of King Ahab, the Moabites, who had been subjugated by Israel, and they had been playing as servants to Israel. When Ahab died, then the kings of Moab said, we will not pay the tribute anymore to Israel. And the son of Ahab, Jehoram, I think, he refused to agree with the insult of the Moabites. And he realized that the Moabites had prepared themselves for war, so he called for his own allies. He called for the king of Judah and the king of Edom. He said, let's go. Support me to fight Moab. The same thing in the realm of the spirit. If you discover that there's an array of army against you in the realm of the spirit or a challenging situation around you, there's nothing wrong in asking your brother to join you in the spiritual battle. So, Jehoram now called Jehoshaphat and the king of Moab, Edom, that let's go. But in the course of the time, say, well, Jehoshaphat said, well, I know that you couldn't tell him that, but this is my perception. Your father didn't trust the prophet, but I still believe in the prophet. Though we are all under the same kingdom, we are in the same church, so as it were. You see, because Judah and Israel is just the same kingdom. But political adversities and other things tore them apart. That is another story which I don't want to go into tonight. You see? Now, there are two kingdoms operating together simultaneously. So there was a king, Jehoshaphat, the king of Judah, and Jehoram, the king of Israel. Now, he co-opted the two others, but Jehoshaphat said, I have not lost my contact with my father God. I pray, no matter who calls you into assistance, even in prayer, let the person understand you are in league with your father in heaven. And Jehoshaphat said, let's call the priest. Let's seek the face of the Lord. And eventually they went, they met with Elisha. And Elisha was already so angry. You know, when you become angry, the Holy Spirit will depart. He was so angry against Jehoram. And then he said, if it were not for the presence of Jehoshaphat, the king of Judah, I wouldn't have even looked at your side. But in his anger, then he said, okay, now get me a minstrel. Let the choir, let them sing a song that my spirit may come, the Holy Ghost may come back unto me. And when the Holy Spirit came back unto him, he now said what I want to read unto you. And I pray, no matter whatever be the case in your life, you will seek the face of the living God. And he said, thus said the Lord, make this valley full of ditches. For thus said the Lord, ye shall not see wind, neither shall ye see rain. Yet the valley shall be filled with water, that ye may drink, both ye and your cattle and your beasts. And this is but a light thing in the sight of the Lord. He will deliver the Moabites also into your hands. Now, he says, he will deliver the Moabites into your hands. He says, this, your miracle, is not going to follow the natural curse. Whatsoever follows the natural curse ceases to be what? A miracle. And when the Moabites came, you see, all the dishes and the water that came, which was supernatural, which was a divine intervention, and by the time they came around, the sun that shone, they made the whole thing to look like blood, and the Moabites had to flee. Israel did not have to raise a sword to fight. That is a miracle. And I pray, every Moabite that have risen against that which is your right, because it was the right of the children of Israel to subjugate the Moabites, and Ahab had already subjugated them, and after the death of Ahab, they now refused to comply, and his son, Jehoram, decided to resist every opposition. I pray every opposition that you have resisted, they will fail, they will fall in Jesus' name. Every Moabite that have risen against you, you will dislodge them, you will destroy them in the mighty name of Jesus. It is not going to be by natural cause. It was a miracle. They didn't have to go there and fight. It was what? A miracle. God will wrought a miracle in your life in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. We are talking about divine abilities. And you'll agree with me that in that 2 Kings chapter 3, that action and the experience there was very, very divine. Then let's look at verse 35. We're doing some analysis of this very text of Luke chapter 1, verse 35. This verse actually confirms the person of the Holy Spirit before the days of Pentecost. Because the angel said that the Spirit of the Lord will overshadow Mary. And the angel answered and said unto her, the Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore, also that holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God. Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit is the third person of the Trinity, and has been there before the day of Pentecost. I pray you will have an encounter with him in Jesus' name. It shall be well with you. Let's go to verse 36, which talks about divine ability could change the state or stigma, name, or condition of a person. When you have a divine encounter with God, you remember that divine ability can be infused into a person. Elizabeth, the Bible says she had been tagged barren. There are some things that had happened to you when people see you. Up to today, we still talk about blind Bartimaeus. Hey, Bartimaeus had regained his sight even in the days of the Lord Jesus Christ. But up to now, they still say blind what? Bartimaeus. It had become a trademark of Bartimaeus that he was blind. Naaman the leper. Naaman had been healed long time ago. But the stigma still remains. Naaman the leper. I pray whatsoever be or become a negative stigma upon your life, they will be removed in the mighty name of Jesus. The angel confirmed that even in the heavens, they knew that men have tagged Elizabeth what? Barren. There is nothing that happens to her that God doesn't know about. The angel said that, hey, you know what? Elizabeth has been called that barren. She's the wife of the pastor. She's not mine. The wife of the pastor is not, you don't know. No, that pastor, that one, that every negative trait, every negative stigma that they are placed on you, I pray they shall be removed in the mighty name of Jesus. So, he has a role, he has a function to play in your life. Divine ability, he could remove every negative thing in your life, and I pray they shall be removed in Jesus' name. Verse 37, the Bible talks about an assertion of the divine ability of God. This is an assertion of the divine ability of God. For with God, nothing shall be impossible. And I believe that, hey, you know, when you face some challenging situation and you are listening to something like I'm preaching now, that with God, nothing shall be impossible. The tendency is to face that situation and say, well, what? Nothing shall be impossible. We are at it now. We are at it. I faced such a situation in my life. Say, with God, nothing shall be impossible. I think I have the time to narrate this. I was to get my visa to go to England. That was 1990. And I didn't take anything. Whatever was required, I didn't have it. No traveler's check, no bank statement, no nothing. No, I mean, I just went to the place to get my visa. Oh, but how possible would that be? I went there. I believe that God has said to me in my closet, I have need of you in England. And I just had an invitation to come attend a wedding. So I decided to go. I didn't have what it takes, and when I was there, I saw everybody, they were checking their documents, and I looked, I said, are we here for the same thing? Traveler's check, bank statement, the record of whatever property that they have. Ah! I look, are we here for the same thing? And when I was thinking like that, normally I carry my tiny Bible, my eyes were sharper than now, that time. I had my Bible in my pocket and I brought it out. It says I should open to Jeremiah 32:27. And I opened and I read. He said, I'm the Lord, the God of all flesh. Is there anything too difficult for me? And I said, no, but we are at it now. I am here at the embassy. I don't have all that it takes. But when I was leaving my house in the morning, I had a prompting of the Holy Spirit. He said I should take one or two of my artworks. It's not related to what I wanted to do. It never made sense. Listen, whatsoever makes so much sense, be very, very careful. It may not be from God. Anything that looks so fantastic, sensible, reasonable, realistic, I'm not condemning things that are real or realistic. If it's about a decision making, be very, very what? Careful. It is not very likely to be from God. It never made any sense, but I just said, well, let me just do it. I took about two of my works of art with me, Fabric. I just wrapped them, put them in the plastic bag, and I carried it. And when it was my turn, I got to the counter, and the guy said, "Why do you choose to go to London for a wedding?" I said, "In fact, I'm not interested in going in the first place." He said, "No." He said, "You are invited, Mr. and Mrs., to come." I said, "Yes." I said, "But it's only me that we go." He said, "But why do you want to go?" I said, "Because I don't even want to go in the first place, but I just think that if I will go to England, I can make contact with one or two studios that may be interested in my work of art as an artist." He said, "Oh, you are an artist?" I said, "Yes." He said, "Do you have any of your works of art around?" I said, "Oh, yes." And I pulled my bag and I put passes under something, and he said, "Wow, you did this?" I said, "Yes." He said, "Are you on leave?" I said, "Yeah, I'm on leave." He said, "Okay, have you gotten this? Your traveler's check?" I said, "No." "Bank statement?" I said, "No, I have my passbook here." I gave him my passbook. It was just 1,020 naira. He said, "Have you bought your flight ticket?" I said, "No." "How do you plan to buy a flight ticket?" I said, "God will provide." He said, "Okay, come on Monday for your visa." I said, "I can't come on Monday because I have a lecture to deliver." He said, "Okay, maybe the following day." Okay, I'll come the next time that's his job. He said, "Okay, come." And I left the place and I went off and I was given my visa. It never made sense. Let's clap for Jesus. It never made any sense. In fact, my younger brother said, "Brother me, if I never knew you to be a chronic SU, I would have thought that you took something to the place to bamboozle the man." Because it never made sense. I can't believe it myself. When I came out of the place, it was difficult for me to believe. I believe God is surprised somebody listened to me. Whatsoever looks too logical and reasonable, be very, very careful. It may not be from God. So before we God, nothing shall be impossible. So that verse clearly tells you, actually tells you about the divine ability of the living God. If you read Mark chapter 10, 27, and the Bible says, "And Jesus, looking upon them, said, with men it is impossible, but not with God. For with God all things are possible." The same thing is repeated in Matthew chapter 19, verse 26. So whatsoever looks impossible in your life, I prophesy to your life that God will make them possible in Jesus' name. And verse 38, the Bible talks about the expression of confidence in and submission to the will of God. The expression, Mary said, "I'm your handmaid, Lord. Be it unto me according to your word." It's an expression of confidence. Jeremiah 29:11. He says, "I know the thought that I think towards you, that the thought of peace and not of evil, to give you what? An expected end." Listen, God is thinking about your future than you ever could imagine. He's thinking more than you could ever sit down. "Hey, how will this thing be?" Don't ever ask that question. That was the question that killed the ministers for finance and economic planning in Samaria. Elisha said that by this time tomorrow, everything will be in abundance. Everything will be sold in penny and coins and not even in a full dollar. He said, "Even if God will open the windows of heaven, can these things be?" And Elisha said, "You will see it, but you're not going to eat thereof." I did not eat. He saw it, but he didn't eat. So the how belongs to God. Is somebody listening to me? The how does what? Belongs to God. Just submit and express confidence in God. What he says he will do, he will do it. I've learned to trust him. Even in the ministry. Once all I want to get first is the green light. If God says, "Go and do this," it may not make sense. I'll just go and do it. I always laugh at the incident that my wife referred to, which I never knew. It was her thinking. I just came from a trip from England to America, and I was at the table. She gave me a very beautiful dish. Some of you may not know the type of, well, but very nice, very nice. And as I was eating, she sat by, keeping my company, eating my food as a very good woman. And I enjoyed the food, and I turned to her, and I said, "You know what? The Lord says tomorrow when I get to church, I should raise $100,000 for the beginning of the construction of the church." She said, "Yeah, amen." It was the evening or the following day that she told me that, "My dear, when you said it yesterday, I thought it was the soup that was very sweet." Because God made it happen. And that is why we are here today. Let's clap for Jesus. It may not make sense. But if you have confidence in your God, and you surrender all to him, that, Father, have your way in my life, he will prove to you that he has a plan for you. And I pray his plan for you shall come to pass. He will demonstrate his divine ability in your life. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. God had given you a measure of his quality and his nature. Verse 38. Verse 38 is an expression of confidence in and submission to the will of God. So every child of God is born with a basic infused divine ability. So I want you to go home today believing that you have a measure of divine ability inherent in you. Do you know, and I've said it before, if you have a potent weapon in your hand, a life ammunition in your hand, and you do not value it or know the function, somebody with a club can kill you. You have the most potent weapon in your hand, but you don't know that this thing can do this. And you are created in the image of God. I'm telling you, you have the ability to make something happen. All I always want to listen to God is to hear what I should do. If he says, do this, I just go ahead to do it. It may not make sense to me. I just continue doing it. And over the time, when I continue doing what he asked me to do, I always see the outcome as positive. And I pray that to be an experience in Jesus' name. In Genesis 1, 26 to 28, and God said, let us make man in our image after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over all the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. Verse 27. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. Verse 28. And God blessed them. And God said unto them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowl of the air and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth. Amen. This is a divine instruction. God has created you with some ability to subdue, the potential strength to rule over the creation of the living God. If you operate lower than expectation, it is not the fault of God. Is somebody listening to me? It is not the what? The fault of God. I wish I remember something. If I remember, I will tell you. I just put it together. I put it in my app. Okay, hold on. It might be very, very helpful. You see, there is this potential is inside you, and until you explore and exploit it, you may not get it. Something will happen to you in your present situation, and if nothing challenges your intelligence, and no one questions your assumed superiority, you are likely to die a mediocre. If nothing challenges your intelligence, and no one questions your assumed superiority, you are likely to die a mediocre. I pray that will not be your portion in Jesus' name. You see, something will challenge you. That which God had put inside you, the present situation that you are looking at, is not something that was supposed to drown you. It is just to challenge you to bring the best out of you. So if nothing challenges your intelligence, and nobody questions your assumed superiority, you just be a mediocre, an average person. I'm doing good. I told you that good is what? A very deceptive state. Because there's something called better, best, excellent. And you are celebrating something that is good. You are in the 16th century. Well, we are in the 21st century now. So something must challenge you. There's a nature of God inside you. Something must challenge your intelligence. Something must question you. People around you must be a source of challenge unto you. I'm telling you, you become the best. But if you're a local champion, when you get to the open, you discover that you're nobody. That will not be your portion. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. So you should understand that you have the nature of God, and your Father calls those that be not as though they were. So you have the same potential ability to do as your Father will do. He has given you the mandate to have dominion, and you have it in Jesus' name. And I put something there, that confidence in God is the springboard for the manifestation of divine abilities. Confidence in God is a springboard for the manifestation of divine ability or abilities, either by God or by you. Hebrews chapter 6, verse 10 says, for God is not unrighteous to forget your works and labor of Lord, which ye have showed unto towards his name, in that ye have ministered unto the saints and do minister. There is a nature to do something within you, you must express it in Jesus' name. 2 Timothy chapter 1, 2 Timothy 1, 5 and 6. Says, when I call to remembrance the unfeigned faith that is in thee, which dwelt first in thy grandmother Lois and thy mother Eunice, and I am persuaded that is in thee also. Says what? Wherefore, I put thee in remembrance that thou share up the gifts of God, which is in thee by the putting on of my hands. He reminded Timothy. He says, cheer up. This gift, your parents, your grandparents have manifested a measure of it, and now you realize it. You gave your life to the Lord Jesus. Now you are here under my tutorial system. I'm now instructing you. I've laid my hands on you. There's a gifting of God in you. There's an impartation of the power of God in you. Share it up. You can't afford to be just, God is going to do it. He will do it tomorrow. Others have achieved what you are talking about. Share up that very gift. You can't afford to just listen. I told we were talking, and I said, somebody said, Pastor Ade, you're overworking yourself. I said, you know what? As long as I have the strength to move, I am still going to do what I believe I should do. If I want to match up with my contemporaries, I cannot go to bed when they go to bed. It's not possible. You're looking for the abilities of God. You are looking for the power of God, and you are not determined to make something happen. You won't get the desired result. It's not a cause. It's a fact. You need to be determined. If you know you want to lead others, I wrote one of my writings, I said, I will never set myself in competition against anybody, but I'm determined to be a pace setter to everybody. I will never set myself in competition against you, but I want to set the pace for your life. That is somebody that believes in his God. Somebody that wants to experience the power of divine ability. You can't expect divine ability to be made manifest in your life and you are redundant. You are so recalcitrant in your thinking about good things. It's not going to happen. It will happen in Jesus' name. Believe him for his word. Stand on the ground of the word of the living God. Devil says it's not going to be. Tell the devil, this is going to be. And I believe it will be. In the mighty name of Jesus. You must be resolutely determined and glorify God in the mighty name of Jesus. And I put it here that the expression of confidence in God does not immune man from the threat of fear. The expression of confidence in God does not immune man from the threat of fear. It is the individual's conviction of confidence that erodes the basis of the fear of failure. The expression of confidence in God does not immune man from the threats of failure. Failure will continue to threaten you, but it is your individual conviction of the confidence that you have in your God that will erode the basis of the fear of failure. You will not fail in Jesus' name. You have that confidence in your God. I think I told you the story of the man that was sent to the house of crab to fetch fresh meat. Go to the house of crab. Where? House of crab. Go and fetch fresh meat. That is where the fresh meat is. House of crab. I think I know crab. Maybe I didn't understand crab. And the guy got to the house of crab. And the crab said, Mr. Man, why are you here? He said, they asked me to come and fetch fresh meat. Fresh meat. Where? He said, here. The person that sent you and yourself, the two of you are very foolish. Look at me. Even my eyes, they are of a shell. Look at my body. It is of shell. Where do you want to look for fresh meat in this house? There's nothing like that. The man went around the house. He couldn't find anything, anybody, anything again. It is only the Mr. Crab. He came back to Mr. Crab and said, I believe the person that sent me. I believe behind this your shell, there must be fresh meat. He descended on the Mr. Crab and the fresh meat came out. You must descend on Mr. Crab of your life. You look at it, it doesn't look like there's any hope. You look at the situation, it doesn't show that you're going to get anything out of it. It looks as if God had asked you to go was just making a mistake. God never made a mistake. He made everything but mistake. Go in there. Mr. Crab, you say there's no meat here. You must be the meat then. He descended on Mr. Crab and the fresh meat came out. I pray you have that strength in Jesus' name. So faith and divine ability. So the manifestation of divine ability is triggered by the act of faith. Hebrews chapter 11 verse 1. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Faith is a tangible substance in the realm of the spirit. You can hold on to your faith. I believe what God told me, and it's going to happen in Jesus' name. So you must be determined. So manifestation of divine ability is triggered by the act of faith. You want to see divine ability in your life, you must have faith. Verse 6 of Hebrews 11 says, but without faith it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Without faith you cannot please God. So you need to develop your faith. You exercise your little faith on something, you make a success, you go to the next level. You continue like that, very soon you start to exercise more faith. Romans chapter 4 verse 17 says, as it is written, I have made thee a father of many nations, before him whom he believed, even God, who quickeneth the dead and calleth those things which be not as though they were. You call the things that be not as though they were. You're going to see a divine ability of God made manifest in your life in Jesus' name. And I believe this is your right as a child of God. John 1:12. As many as received him, he gave them what? The power to become. And I've said repeatedly, you are given the power to become. It does not say you are already. Am I making sense to somebody? May I ask you, are you a child of God? Because I've been talking with some authority and confidence that this is not going to be, if you don't do this, this is going to be, if you do this. Listen, that is only for children of God. That is only for those who know their God. Daniel 11:32 says, as many as do wickedly against the covenant, they shall be deceived by flatteries. But they that do know their God, they shall be strong and do express. So all these things we have spoken about, they are for children of God. If you're not yet a full-fledged child of God, you can make up your mind now. Because this is your right. I am not from the outer space. I have been challenging paths of darkness anywhere I've ever been to. I just came back from London. I mean, a few days now. And we're talking about all the incidents that happened there. We thank God for Jesus. I can't waste time to say, well, you knew this, you saw this, you saw this. We give God the glory. This same God had not changed. If you give your life to him, absolutely. The authority that I'm emphasizing today is your portion. You will leave this place with confidence that he's going to do it. And if there's a problem in your life that needs to be resolved and solved and taken care of, he will take care of it tonight. I want us to rise. I want us to go before him. If you have not given your life to the Lord Jesus, there's no better time than now. You could have been playing church. You could have been coming to church and listening to so many sermons. You have listened to so many televangelists. But are you living right? If the devil comes, John chapter 14 verse 30, Jesus Christ said, the prince of this world cometh and he finds nothing in me. If the devil comes, will he find something in you that he can build up to destroy you? If Christ wants to present you, Ephesians 5:27, said that he might present you and I unto himself, a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that should be holy and without blemish. Is there any blemish in your life? Is there any of those such things in your life? Immorality, you know the sinful nature, you know the basic non-recognized sins. If there is any that you know the devil can accuse you of, I want to appeal to you. Confess them before God right now. 1 John 1:7, 8, and 9. As if walk in the light, as he is in the light. The blood of Jesus Christ is our cleansing us from all sin.
Refreshing Ministries International presents their 6th annual convention. The theme is The Finger of God. From Thursday evening, September 25th, to Sunday afternoon, September 28th, come to experience anointed worship, sound teaching, prevailing prayer, divine healing, and more. We will be blessed with the presence of Reverend Dr. and Reverend Gabriel Olu Farambi, Pastors Ade and Grace Okonrende, and Reverend and Mrs. Alaba Obiri. You are welcome to join us at the RCCG Pavilion of Redemption, 15227 Old Richmond Road, Sugarland, Texas, 774 9:8.